Dear students, in this video, we will discuss Carnot's heat engine and an important cyclic process occurring inside Carnot's heat engine, that is Carnot's cycle. We will be deriving the expression for the efficiency of a heat engine and also discuss how Carnot's theorem or Carnot's principle explains the second law of thermodynamics. In order to overcome the limitations of the first law, there came another law called the second law of thermodynamics. And according to second law of thermodynamics, no heat engine can have 100% efficiency because there must always be some heat transfer to the environment, which is often called waste heat. Then the question arises, how efficient can a heat engine be? In 1824, a young French military engineer, S. Carnot, devised a theoretical cycle, and now it's called the Carnot cycle, which is the most efficient cyclical process possible. So he devised an engine, a heat engine, which employs the Carnot cycle. So any heat engine employing the Carnot cycle is called a Carnot engine or Carnot's heat engine. It is an idealized theoretical heat engine or heat machine in which heat energy is transformed into mechanical work. And Carnot proposed certain conclusions that can be taken as a basis for the second law. Now let's see what is a Carnot's heat engine, what are its different parts, and what are the different processes occurring inside a Carnot's heat engine. The Carnot's heat engine consists of a cylinder fitted with a non-conducting frictionless piston. It also has a heat reservoir or source, that is a very hot body of infinite thermal capacity maintained at constant temperature, say T2 Kelvin. It also has a thermally insulated jacket in order to ensure adiabatic conditions. And inside this jacket, the cylinder can be placed. The heat engine also has a heat reservoir or sink of infinite thermal capacity maintained at a constant temperature, for example, T1 Kelvin, such that T1 is less than T2. So here the temperatures T1 and T2 are those on the ideal gas temperature scale, which is usually taken as a Kelvin scale of temperature. That's why we have mentioned T2 Kelvin and T1 Kelvin. And here T1 is less than T2. And also the temperature of the source and the temperature of the sink will not change by addition or removal of heat because they have infinite thermal capacity. So these are the different parts of a Carnot's heat engine. Now let's discuss the processes occurring inside Carnot's heat engine. This is a cyclic process and that is called Carnot's cycle. Okay, so the working substance is 1 mole of an ideal gas that is subjected to a series of 4 successive processes. So let's see what are the different processes. This diagram represents the Carnot cycle on a pressure volume diagram. The first step is isothermal expansion. The gas cylinder is placed in contact with the heat reservoir or source, which is at a higher temperature, that is T2 Kelvin. So when the gas cylinder is placed at a heat reservoir, it absorbs heat from the source, it absorbs heat Q2. So when the gas absorbs heat, what happens? The gas expands isothermally and reversibly from volume V1 to V2. That is from A to B here in the graph. A corresponds to volume V1 and B corresponds to volume V2. So the gas will slowly undergo isothermal reversible expansion from A to B and the volume will increase from V1 to V2. The work done will be W1 equals minus RT2 log V2 by V1. This is a general expression for the work done during isothermal reversible expansion of an ideal gas. So W1 equals minus RT2 log V2 by V1. We know that during an isothermal process, the temperature is constant. That means there is no change in the internal energy. Delta U equals 0. According to first law of thermodynamics, we know that delta U equals Q plus W. So when delta U equals 0, we can write Q equals minus W. Therefore, the heat absorbed Q2 equals minus W1. We have represented Q2 because the heat is absorbed from the source, which is at a temperature T2. So Q2 equals minus W1, which is equal to RT2 log V2 by V1. So we have two equations. One is the equation for work done, W1 equals minus RT2 log V2 by V1. And the other is heat absorbed Q2, which is equal to minus W1. That is equal to RT2 log V2 by V1. So this is the first step. Now the second step is adiabatic expansion. So in order to undergo adiabatic expansion, the cylinder is now placed in a non-conducting jacket to ensure adiabatic conditions. The gas is allowed to expand reversibly and adiabatically from volume V2 to V3, that is from B to C in the graph. Here we can see that the point B corresponds to volume V2 and C corresponds to volume V3. So the gas is expanding reversibly and adiabatically from B to C, that is volume will change from V2 to V3. And since it is an adiabatic process, there is no heat flow in or out of the system, that is Q equals 0. And when an ideal gas undergoes reversible adiabatic expansion, the temperature falls from T2 Kelvin to T1 Kelvin. Why? Because the work is done at the expense of its internal energy. So delta U equals W2, which is equal to Cv into T1 minus T2. Or we can write delta U equals W2 equal to minus Cv into T2 minus T1. So in adiabatic expansion, Q equals 0. According to first law of thermodynamics, delta U equals Q plus W. So since Q equals 0, delta U equals W. So here delta U equals W2 equals Cv into T1 minus T2 or minus Cv into T2 minus T1. Now the third step is isothermal compression. So the cylinder is placed in contact with the heat reservoir, which is at a lower temperature, that is T1 Kelvin. Now the gas is compressed isothermally and reversibly from volume V3 to V4, that is from C to D. The volume decreases from V3 to V4. Now since work is done on it, it gives up heat to the reservoir. Heat Q1 is given to the reservoir. So the work done is W3 equals minus RT1 log V4 by V3. Again, since delta U equals 0 because it is an isothermal process, so the heat given out Q1 is equal to minus W3. So that is equal to RT1 log V4 by V3. Here V4 is less than V3. So that means Q will be a negative quantity. And this Q1 is the heat given out during the isothermal compression. So the third step is the isothermal compression. Now we go to the last step, that is the adiabatic compression. So in order to get adiabatic conditions, the cylinder is again placed in the non-conducting jacket. The gas is compressed reversibly and adiabatically from V4 to V1, that is from D to A in this graph. So it is returning back to the initial position. So work is done on the system. Since it is an adiabatic compression, the temperature increases from T1 to T2 due to increase in its internal energy. The change in internal energy, that is delta U equals W4, that is equal to Cv into T2 minus T1. Final temperature minus initial temperature, that is T2 minus T1. So these are the four different steps inside a Carnot's heat engine or in a Carnot cycle. So we have two isothermal processes and two adiabatic processes. The first two are expansion process, isothermal expansion and adiabatic expansion, followed by isothermal compression and adiabatic compression. So the net work done by the system in the whole cycle will be W equals W1 plus W2 plus W3 plus W4. That is equal to minus RT2 log V2 by V1 minus CV T2 minus T1 minus RT1 log V4 by V3 plus CV into T2 minus T1. So that is equal to minus RT2 log V2 by V1 minus RT1 log V4 by V3. Or we can represent it as minus W equals RT2 log V2 by V1 plus RT1 log V4 by V3. So this is the total work or net work done by the system in the Carnot cycle. The net heat absorbed Q equals Q2 plus 0 plus Q1 plus 0. In step 2 and 4, those are adiabatic steps. So there is no heat exchange, so Q is 0. So we only have Q2 plus Q1. That is equal to RT2 log V2 by V1 plus RT1 log V4 by V3. So when we look at these two equations, equation A and B, the right hand side is same. So that means Q equals minus W. And this is an essential condition to be satisfied for a cyclic process because delta U equals 0. Delta U equals Q plus W according to first law. So if Q equals minus W means delta U equals 0, which is the condition for a cyclic process. So we have obtained Q equals minus W equals this equation. Now for an adiabatic process, TV raised to gamma minus 1 is a constant where gamma equals Cp by Cv. So consider the two adiabatic steps, that is step 2 and step 4. So we can write the equation as T2 V2 gamma minus 1 equals T1 V3 raised to gamma minus 1. Also T2 V1 raised to gamma minus 1 equals T1 V4 raised to gamma minus 1. This is for step 2 and the second one is for step 4. So dividing these two equations, we get V1 by V2 equals V4 by V3. So in this equation, substitute for V4 by V3 and we will get RT1 log V1 by V2. So on rearranging, we will get Q equals minus W equals R into T2 minus T1 log V2 by V1. Since all the steps in the Carnot cycle are reversible, this equation represents the maximum convertibility of heat into work. Now let's see what is the efficiency of a heat engine. Efficiency eta is usually defined as the work performed divided by the heat absorbed. So that is equal to minus W by Q2. So when we substitute the equation for minus W, that is the work done, and heat absorbed Q2, we will get eta equals T2 minus T1 by T2. Or we can also represent eta as 1 minus T1 by T2. The efficiency will always be a positive quantity because here W is the work done by the system, which is a negative quantity. That means minus W will be positive. So here, that is eta equals 1 minus T1 by T2. That means this right hand side is less than 1. So if it is less than 1 means W is numerically less than Q2. That is the heat absorbed Q2 is not fully converted into work. Rather, a portion of it is given out during the lower temperature step. And this is what is known as the second law of thermodynamics. That is, heat cannot be completely converted to work. A small portion of it will be given out, which is represented as Q1. And based on these observations, Carnot arrived at certain conclusions, which is summarized as Carnot's theorem. The Carnot's first theorem is all reversible heat engines working between the same two limits of temperatures have the same efficiency, independent of the working fluid. We have seen that the efficiency eta equals T2 minus T1 by T2. So that means it depends only upon the initial and the final temperatures, or the temperatures of the source and the sink. And it is independent of the gas taken in the cylinder. Now the Carnot's second theorem is, no heat engine can be more efficient than a reversible one operating between the same two limits of temperatures. So on the basis of Carnot cycle, we can state the second law of thermodynamics as, it is impossible to convert heat completely into an equivalent amount of work. So this diagram represents the failure to convert heat completely into work. So here you can see that some portion of the heat is transferred to the reservoir at lower temperature. In all real heat engines, some of the heat absorbed from the source is discarded into the sink, that is at a lower temperature, and it's not converted into work. Only a portion of it is converted to work. Or we can also say that there has to be an effective transfer of some heat from a hot to a cold reservoir to make the process cyclic and continuous. And the second law of thermodynamics is a generalization, which expresses this practical failure to convert heat completely into work.